these are white rats. So people thought kind of a witch and all that.
One of the major things that is going to drive growth in the coming 4 or 5 years is this oil discovery.
Speak to 5 people about starting a business in such unprecedented times, and the answer could be the same. Who starts a business when others are closing? Well, it's often said in business that every challenge is an opportunity, so think twice. Hello and welcome to The Business Show. Here are major stories that made the headlines in the business world this week, locally and internationally.
Fintechs urged to open up and allow interoperability within their platforms to lower transaction costs between digital platforms. This is expected to supplement successes registered by previous financial inclusion. Long-distance truck drivers have resumed their work of delivering merchandise to South Sudan after weeks as trucks pile up at the Uganda-South Sudan border. Across the globe, a U.S. judge has ruled that Boeing's board of directors must face a lawsuit from shareholders over 2 fatal crashes involving its 737 MAX planes. The judge ruled that the real victims were those who died and their families, but investors had also lost billions of dollars. And 888 agrees to buy William Hill's European business. The online gambling firm said the deal with casino giant Casino's Entertainment would involve William Hill's 1,400 UK betting shops.
In recent weeks, the media has been awash with stories of multinationals closing stores and heading back to their parent countries. The obvious reason for many is that the economy is so hard and businesses cannot post profits. But is that so? This week on Views from the Top, Stefan Caballo from Alpha Capital Partners weighs in on this.
My name is Stephen Caballo. I'm the Managing Director of Alpha Capital. Alpha Capital, we're a financial advisory firm, and we do a number of other business activities, such as asset management, forex trading, and of course, the major one. And the basis for this discussion is financial advisory. Yes, in the last couple of years, we've seen exodus of a number of multinationals and regional companies. It all started with the Kenyan food or grocery stores that had made entry in the early 2000s. And could not continue a business here in Uganda. In particular, Nakumat, Uchumi, recent Tuskies. So those regional businesses could not cope locally here, but we shall come to the reasons. Then very recently, we've seen the announcement of ShopRite, which was closely followed by Game Stores, announcing their exit from the Ugandan market. So, from my own analysis, I can say there are a number of reasons behind this, exiting of the Ugandan market, especially in the space of grocery stores, grocery market, so to speak. So I can pick on at least 4 fundamental reasons. The first one is broadly the market dynamics. When you look at the history of these companies, They came in 18 years ago. The market dynamics were totally different. Outlook was totally different. Over time, the market trends have shifted in the sense that competition from similar local players has set in. These are the likes of Quality Supermarket, the likes of Mega. Those are local sort of peers that have put a lot of pressure on these multinationals or regional players, if you like. Now, competition coming from what angle? When you look at the business models for these local players, they lean towards less imports, more of the local produced goods, which plays in tune with the buy Uganda, build Uganda. So you'll see the import element of the local players is skewed towards local products, which means that they probably pay less taxes, they require less foreign exchange to be able to bring goods that compete with these other regional multinational players in the local terrain. So that is one particular element. So buying local, importing less sets the stage. And also, when you look at it from a business perspective, importation, taxation, shelf life, all those sort of complicate the story. Then, when you look at the market trends, you'll see that traditional grocery stores or corner shops, as the economy develops, neighborhoods develop, satellite towns develop, you'll find more concentration of corner shops around where everybody lives, where the masses live. Very convenient, and they take away the need to come to this brick and mortar downtown. Now, I'm telling you about market trends changing. Today, if you take an example of somebody who lives in the neighborhood of Najera or Ontina, they find it very difficult to drive to game stores downtown or shop right at Acacia Mall because of the traffic. Traffic is just a nightmare. So it makes it convenient for them to go and buy at the corner shop, at the nearest grocery store, which is in the neighborhood. You'll see that concentration of these multinationals, these regional players, is around the central business district. They don't go very far off. You'll find maybe in the radius of 5 kilometers, but that's not where everybody lives. That's the concentration, that's the central business district. So lack of presence or footprint in the neighborhoods is also another reason that creates competition from these small local players. Because literally what you can get in game, you can get it at a corner shop. Now, there is then the pricing dimension. Pricing is structured in a way that the average unit cost of a product is much lower in those corner grocery shops than these high-end shops in the nice areas of Kampala. So you find that these regional players, the game, the shop rights, their niche market is expatriate community, which live very close to the city. But where are the volumes? Is that enough turnover? that is there a critical mass? So part of lack of a critical mass has also put a dent in their business model. So pricing, we have talked about, average unit price is much lower in those other shops. Now, again, going by the market trends, we've seen online shopping taking center stage. Now, online shopping shoppers have increased over time. Digitalizing the economy is one of the aspects that has been the buzz in the last, say, 7 years or so. This is a picking steam. You can order anything from Jumia today and they'll deliver it to your home. No need to go to Game. And that's perhaps even cheaper. So that is also now playing. 10, 15, 20 years ago, online shopping was a strange idea in this economy. So the economy is changing, and we've seen that online shopping taking shape. Then, in the last 2 years, this huge animal called COVID-19 has changed the way business is done. It does not matter in what sector you're in, the dynamics have changed. The costs of doing business, and we can go to examples, cost of doing business under COVID pandemic have increased for these big shops. You'll have to put their sanitizers, temperature gun, those who ensure that SOPs are being managed, all kinds of things. Even in other facilities, you find that there's limitation in the business hours. Business starts at 9, stops at 5. As opposed to many years ago when you can run 9 to 9. Now, even the costs of maintaining your staff, you may lay off, but perhaps those that you have to be, you know, sort of sanitized. The sanitizing them against COVID means they will sleep on the premises. They'll not even go home. That is at a cost. Now, bringing them, for those that you have to transport in these COVID times, you probably have to hire a bus to bring them together because they will not allow them to come, especially during the lockdown. So the costs to do business under the COVID pandemic has become quite heavy for these players, adding to their costs. Now, so considering the current and the future operating business environment, it looks a little bit tricky. Going back to particular cases, you'll find that these regional players or multinationals have been carrying heavy losses, or they're at the break-even point. Now, that is not a sustainable business to have. So that's part of the problem coming from the reasons that I have alluded to. So when you put all those together, it makes the business environment very, very tough. Government has done a commendable job by being able to put in place conditions for doing business in terms of laying out the infrastructure. Infrastructure is quite developed, and that is continuing. Ways of improving the business environment, I think that's an ongoing process. It keeps improving over and over again. Incentives which drive investment in terms of free market economy that is in place, in terms of demography, we offer very interesting demographic profile. Anybody, because our population is our biggest population is between 18 and 35. One of the major things that is going to drive growth in the coming 4 or 5 years is this oil discovery. It is a game changer for this economy. Now, for any person who has put countries in Africa on the radar to look for where is an attractive market that one would go and invest, Uganda stands out. So, in immediate short term, we may have challenges. Long term, there are bright prospects for this economy and for any investor that would come, would want to come.
Amazing debate, I must say, and as a business person, you must remain innovative so as to give what the market wants and not what you are willing to supply to the market. Time for a break now. See you shortly.